Let us pray. God, our God, we bless you and we give you thanks that your name is honored and glorified in every season, in every time, and in every place. We bless you that you are God all by yourself, and that you have called us to be your people, to be persons who have joined you in redeeming the world. And so we bless you and give you thanks that your word is powerful, and your word accomplishes many things and will never return unto you void. So we have heard the reading of your word, and we pray now that you'd bless its interpretation, that the interpretation of your word will be accurate, and that it will come forth with power and conviction, with grace and precision, and with a whole lot of anointing of your Holy Spirit. So speak to us now as only you alone can. Uphold me that I may proclaim Jesus Christ alone for salvation. So let the words of my mouth and the reflections of our hearts be pleasing in your sight, O God, our strength and our Redeemer. And the people of God say, Amen and Amen. Friends, the story is told that in 1910, yes, 1910, a man by the name of Olafson was desperate for money. So he sold his body to an institute in Sweden to be used for medical research after he died. But in 1911, he unexpectedly inherited a fortune and decided to buy himself back. To his surprise, the institute wouldn't cooperate. Shocked by this, Olafson flatly refused to donate his body, so the institute actually sued for breach of contract. The court found that not only did Olafson owe his body to the institute, but since he had two teeth extracted without the institute's permission, Olafson had illegally tampered with their property and had to pay a huge sum for tampering with his own body, but with the property of the institute. My brothers and sisters, conflict is everywhere. It's in the workplace. When we become irritated with our coworkers, angry with our boss. It's in the neighborhood, in our schools, in the classroom, at the bus stop, and on the playing field as our children struggle to settle disputes in an amicable way. And no doubt you have seen the footage recently of numerous fights among our children in school uniform as they struggle to work through their differences and to do so by respecting each other's boundaries and each other's humanity. It has now become commonplace to hear of parents who visit the schools not to find meaningful ways of having conversations about how their children's well-being and performances in school. But we have heard of parents who show up to fight who fight a teacher for disciplining a student. And you ask yourself, what example is that to the children? We have many challenges with families. Families struggle sometimes, especially after the matriarch or the patriarch or that person who holds the family together dies. And there is dispute about inheritance. And some families have problems with the family next door. The family next door with a dog that constantly barks at all hours of the night. Husband and wife, parents and their children, even in the church. We can become very angry with each other sometimes in the name of the Lord. Nations against nation. Sections of the population against another section based on race, class, religion, or worldview. Again, I submit to you that conflict is all around us. We find it difficult to get along. The Bible tells us that after Adam sinned, that when God confronted Adam, Adam blamed God and Adam blamed his wife. Conflict. He said, the woman you put here with me, she gave me some fruit from the tree and I ate it. And the woman then blamed the serpent. And the blame game began when sin entered into the world. And conflict followed right behind. But there are generally two ways that many people deal with conflict or with disputes. One, denial. A very common response to conflict among persons is denial. Just deny that the problem exists and maybe it will go away. I don't know what you are talking about. I think everything is fine. Everything is okay. Or if you cannot reasonably deny that a problem exists, you at least try to ignore it. And you especially don't take any steps towards a biblical resolution. Because that would be uncomfortable. We simply want it to go away. And there are some persons who give you the silent treatment. They just shut up, shut down. They don't draw their breath to you, as the old people would say. And so they choose the silent treatment. It's easier just to live with the elephant in the room. In a worst case scenario, the conflict is so severe that some persons consider suicide. They see it as the only way in order to deal with the situation, just die. And that's one way. The other way that some persons deal with conflict is to fight, fight, fight. As we continue to slide down this slippery slope, the next response we come to is to fight, fight, fight. We fight back. We go to war. We use harsh or angry words. We file lawsuits. We might even use physical means, slapping, hitting, cuffing, fights, road rage, domestic disputes.
In a worst case scenario, the conflict is so severe that there are some persons who consider and carry out murder. It really does happen in our world, in our society. Fight responses might also include moving out of the house, getting a divorce, cutting off a friendship, quitting a job, or leaving the church and go to the other church where there is no conflict. And that's why some people keep moving like rolling stones. Now, in some cases, any one of these actions might be appropriate in some cases, especially where there is physical or emotional abuse. However, we run into problems when we jump straight to one of these responses without carefully taking steps to resolve the issue. There are many people who make it a habit, whenever they experience significant conflict, to cut off relationship, burning their bridges, and then moving on to the next thing. What happened? What's wrong with that strategy, you may ask? Your problem tends to follow you. Also, at some point, you end up burning all your bridges and have nowhere to go. However, in the midst of this world of discord, Christ said in his word, "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called sons and daughters of God." Matthew 5. In describing those who are part of the kingdom of heaven, he said that they would be known for working for peace and resolving discord. How do godly people resolve conflict? How do we become the peacemakers that God has raised us up to be? Many people think being a peacemaker means being a pushover. And it does not mean that at all, because we must be able to stand up for righteousness, for justice, but to do so in a way that preserves the humanity of the other and bring glory and honor to God. In the passage that we have read from Job, Job has a dispute with God. And he calls God to a sit-down. Job feels that he has been offended by God, that he has been treated badly by God. The same Job who in the first several chapters was defending God. The same Job who was saying, "The Lord giveth and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord." The same Job that said to his wife, "You speak like a foolish woman. Should we expect good from the hand of God and not bad?" Eventually, this Job broke, and this Job began to challenge God. He had a dispute with God, and he wanted to settle it. And Job used language that we use every day. He says, "God, if you were a man, I would take you to court, and I will present my case, and I'm sure I will win because I have a case against you. God, show up. God, let's have this contest." So there's a conflict going on here. Job is having a dispute with God. And after several chapters of ranting and several chapters of calling God to account for God's action, in chapter 38, which we have read from earlier, God finally spoke after several chapters of silence. And I love what God does. As God spoke to Job for the first time after several chapters of ranting, God never answered any of the questions that Job asked. God never responded to any of the things that Job raised. But what God did was to broaden Job's perspective. Because God realized that Job was making a case based on a very small piece of the picture that he saw. Job did not see the full picture. Job did not have all knowledge. And so Job saw just one part of the picture, and Job was making a judgment based on that one snippet of the picture. And so in God's response, God basically said to Job, you do not have all of your facts. There are so many other things that need to be considered. And God began to show Job a wider, broader perspective. A number of things that Job did not realize, that Job missed. And so God was helping Job to get a broader picture of what is. And you know what? So often, many conflicts are based on a narrow vision of what is. Very often we enter into conflict, into war with people because of the snippet of the story that we have seen, that we know, that is our reality. And we make judgments based on that snippet. And as a faith community, as people who are in relationship with each other and with God, we must be in the business before we jump to conclusions, before we take sides, before we prop people up in their position. We must always endeavor as far as we are able to help people to see a broader perspective of what is, a broader picture. How can we help them to see the fuller picture at one glance? And by so doing, we are able to mitigate what could become a major life-wrenching, life-changing scenario. And we see this in Job and God's relationship and interaction and going back and forth. God brought Job to a place of seeing a bigger picture. And there are some of us who are so hasty in our judgment that the first thing we hear and the first thing that we see, we go no further and we make judgments based on that. Judgments that ruin relationships. Judgments that create untenable situations. Judgments that cause hurts and lead to brokenness. Broken relationships, broken lives, broken homes, broken society. And God would have me say to us that we must be in the business of wanting to see the broad picture before we jump to conclusions. But as we also look at the gospel reading from Mark 10, something is happening here as well. This time it is between the disciples. Two of them were hungry for power. They wanted to be executives in Jesus' government. They wanted high positions. And so they went behind the backs of the others and had a secret conversation with Jesus and asked for special places. Lord, when you come into your kingdom, let me sit at your right hand and my brother at your left hand. Let us have very special positions in your government. And then the other disciples heard about it. And according to Mark, they were angry.
And it is what Mark did not tell us that concerns me. Because there's no doubt that that anger was visible and may have been audible. No doubt that that anger led to quarrels. No doubt that anger led to suspicions. No doubt that that anger was of such that it could have broken up the group. And I love again how Jesus responded. And Jesus teaches us a couple of things. Firstly, Jesus teaches us to resolve conflict. Godly people must not ignore the problems. So Jesus did not ignore the problem. Jesus recognized that this request was made. Jesus recognized that the other disciples were offended by the request. Jesus recognized that the other disciples were angry because these two had made this request. And Jesus did not simply say, "It will go away." Jesus did not simply say, "Let's ride it through." Jesus did not simply ignore that there was a problem that was festering within the community. No, Jesus did not ignore the problem. And neither should we. And there are so many persons who recognize that there are major problems in their lives and their relationships with other people, and they ignore the problems and they suffer silently. They suffer alone. They become, as a result, unhappy human beings. And they become bitter human beings. And so sometimes you meet people who come across at the first moment as bitter, resentful, and sometimes even rude. And if you get to know them well enough, you discover that that is not really their nature. It is because of life's situations that they are confronted with, which they have never acknowledged and dealt with. And as a result, it begins to poison them on the inside. And even though they initially were bitter with one person, they simply ignore it and then become bitter human beings. And everybody who interacts with them gets a taste of the bitterness. But that bitterness started with one person, one relationship that went bad, one person who broke their hearts, one person who they became distrusting of. And because it was ignored, it basically takes over their personality. And they become people that you just don't want to live with or keep company with. And so Jesus, by his very action, is saying to us that we cannot ignore that there is an issue. Secondly, to resolve conflict, godly people must develop a righteous anger. Many leaders just bypass problems and never address them. They may do this in part because they are apathetic towards the situation. Therefore, they never develop a righteous anger which leads to fixing problems. And this righteous anger that I'm talking about is where we become uncomfortable with certain realities. Is where we recognize that we just cannot live with the existence of certain things in our society. And slowly, if you recognize, we are becoming very uncomfortable with disrespect. We are becoming very comfortable with ill-discipline. It no longer bothers us to the core. And so there are some things we see and we normalize them. And I've seen so much of that by watching the news of the U.S. election. There's so many nonsense that are normalized.
So many things that people just simply say, oh, it's just another day. And slowly we are getting there as a society. There are too many things that we see that we know are wrong and will poison the soul of the nation. And we simply think it's another day, it will go away. There needs to be a holy anger, a holy indignation, a holy indignation that tells us we will not allow this to fester. We will not allow this situation or this way of living and behaving to become a part of our society. No, we will take a stand. We will walk with people. We will journey with people. We will come alongside people. We will meet people where they are, but we cannot simply accept this as a norm. And we see that with Jesus. This holy indignation. When Jesus went into the temple and he saw the way that the temple was being defiled, he developed a holy indignation that says this has to be cleansed. And he then moved and took steps to have it cleansed. And even the situation that is before us, Jesus took on a holy indignation. Basically determined that this will not fester in this community of disciples. The other thing that I want you to notice, that to resolve conflict, godly people must set the example. See how Jesus dealt with this thing? Jesus recognizes a problem, there's a holy indignation, and Jesus points to himself. I, your Lord and teacher, I do not come promoting myself over you, but rather I have washed your feet. And so I say to you, do likewise, because the first shall be last and the last shall be first. In other words, Jesus calls for humility. Jesus calls for humble service. If we are going to help to resolve many of the issues in our world, in our society, people must not be able to point their fingers at us. We cannot deal with the issue of injustice if we practice injustice. We cannot deal with the issue of corruption if we practice corruption. We cannot deal with the issue of integrity in public life if there are holes to be poked in our lack of integrity in public life or in personal life. In other words, if we are going to help to resolve the challenges of our time, we must be above board. I'm not saying that any of us would be squeaky clean, even though Jesus invites us to be that, to be perfect as he's perfect. But we must not become an obstacle in our own way. We must not become the cause of others falling. We must not become the negative examples. We must not become the poison to the soul of the nation. And let me say finally, to resolve conflict, godly people must have discernment. Jesus recognized that something was wrong. We are not told that any of the disciples went to him and said, Lord, we know what these two did and we are angry, we are upset. Jesus recognized it. Jesus recognized that something is different today. Maybe as they gathered for morning prayer, Jesus realized that the countenances were falling. Jesus realized that they were not as close and chummy as they usually would be, and Jesus recognized that something is going on here. And so I'm saying to us that we have to be more aware of our context. Especially when it comes to our children, parents have to be more aware Families have to be more aware of each other. You know when something is out. You know when something is off. And if you ignore your instinct, you can end up with situations that become life-threatening. And so, my brothers and sisters, I want to challenge you, even as I challenge myself. This is the world in which we live. This is it. While God can send angels from on high to clean up this world, he's not going to do it that way because he has angels on earth. He has you and he has me. And he has called us to be the difference that we want to see. He says it begins with us. If each of us take a little more care and a little more time with each other and for each other, our world can be a better place. So stop simply asking, "How are you?" simply to be polite, but stop and hear the answer. And be available to journey with those who are not well, those who are hurting, those who are troubled. And let us make a little heaven on earth. In that prayer we say during communion, we say, "This is a foretaste of the heavenly banquet prepared for all mankind," which means that the way that we live out our Christianity is a reflection of what will be in its fullness when we come into the kingdom. And so if we can't figure out how to live with each other on earth, you want to go to heaven with these same people? And you think somehow that because you get to heaven, you're going to figure out how to live with them? You got to start now. We have to start now to figure out how to live with each other. So I want to challenge you, as I challenge myself and as I challenge the church. Let us rise up and be more aware of each other. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen.